My topic tonight is our wealth and its enemies. These are some theses from my new book, which will come out maybe next spring. So I'm in the middle of writing and thinking through this, and maybe you can help me. I will give you some of my theses and then we should discuss it. Okay? So you're invited to an exchange of ideas, and don't be too polite. I'm a journalist. So it's a great honor for me to speak here in Maastricht, and it's a great pleasure too. What an amazing university. I've heard a lot about it. I hope that everything you learned here is worthwhile, that you invest so many time, energy, and nerves to this time-consuming habit of doing these studies. At least I hope you do better than I have done. As it turns out, my time at university was completely useless. For years, I learned the wrong stuff. I learned about the invisible hand of Adam Smith and from Karl Marx that we have to help the poor, because if we don't do this, they will organize and there will be a revolution. From John Maynard Keynes, I learned about deficit spending in bad times and saving in good times. And from our history books, I get some flavor. What does it mean to have a great inflation? And that's why our founding fathers made the commitment to a Bundesbank, to a reserve bank, which should be independent to prevent catastrophic financial events. But sadly, as it turns out, during my lifetime, I wasted my time with all these guys. Everything I learned about a market economy seems to be completely wrong. My head is a storage room of dead ideas. Instead of the invisible hand structuring the way markets balance supply and demand, we have got the iron fist of the government. Today, governments like the US government or the German government are structuring the financial sector and the car industry in the United States too. I don't recall Adam Smith writing anything about General Motors, A&G, Lehman, Bear Stearns, or other industries too big to fail. But I would like to hear his opinion about that. He never used this phrase. The same goes for Marx. Today, we are not helping the poor. We are supporting the fat cats of Wall Street. The philosopher, the German philosopher Peter Sloterdijk, recently called this socialism for the rich. And he is right. After collecting billions from ordinary taxpayers, our government gave these billions to our big banks, which resulted in increased executive pay bonuses on Wall Street, in London, and in Frankfurt as well. That's not the sort of charity I normally want to support. What happened to Keynes? It looks like a big misunderstanding if you take the national debt into account. Literally, no one is saving during good times, which may be the reason why we don't have good times anymore. America has overstretched the dollar, and that's what Greece, Italy, Portugal, Ireland, Spain, which they all have done with the euro. We are living in a highly leveraged world. If you want to meet the real money and the real savers, you have to travel to China or some distant part of the world. You don't find any saver in the United States, whether it's a government official or a private household. It's really hard to find them. Only in Germany, some of them are located. And our Reserve Bank? Well, it seems to have changed its own job description. These guys are not protecting the stability of our currency anymore. Instead, they are undermining its stability. They are pouring in tons of cash into the money market. Liquidity is king. That's what they believe in. I wish I had spent my university time on more useful things rather than studying all that stuff, which seems meaningless for our today's politics. Maybe I should have gone to more parties, met more girls, had traveled instead of sitting in a windowless classroom like this. At least I would feel better. Now I have all this wrong thinking in my head. Maybe the modern times are too modern for me. We can discuss this. Maybe the new normal seems not my normal. Maybe I'm too old for all this. The heroes of my days, Smiths, Marx, Keynes, are all gone, seemingly stranded on the garbage hill of history. The only thing which makes me hesitating is, well, why the hell are all the big spenders claiming victory? Why they are not doing this? Why are the financial crisis still is in our headlines? How did the fire, which started burning in the US subprime market, spread to Lehman Brothers, Bear Stearns, and the other big banks, then began attacking Greece, Spain, and now the European Monetary Union? Why this crisis is not over yet, if all these new normal things would happen? Why is inequality on the rise? After all that national debt we have in our books, if we gave all this money to poor people, as a lot of politicians has predicted and promised, why are all the numbers of inequality like they are? Why we are so unhappy as society about these things? Maybe we should think the unthinkable. Maybe the classics weren't wrong, but the heroes of our times are. Let's have a closer look at the enemies of our wealth creation. There are always people who try to undermine the system, which we learned were the unions, the communists, lazy people on welfare who cheat the state. That's what my teachers told me. And even this turned out to be wrong. Very rich people and very powerful institutions cheated our system. The banking community broke their promises. And London's leading banks faked and manipulated even the interest rates. As you know, the unions, that's the way we have to look at it today, were more responsible than the board of directors of Barclays Bank. In the political arena, we see the same strange picture. Conservative politicians like George W. Bush, Mr. Sarkozy, or our German Angela Merkel created huge stimulus packages which pushed budgets over the cliff. Today, our market economy is under friendly fire from those who told us they would love it forever. The strange thing is, it seems like an attack plan without an attack, without a plan, exactly. It looks like a conspiracy without conspirators. And it's a design for disaster, which nobody has claimed intellectual property rights so far. Maybe that's the real lesson for all of us. Evolution is underway. Even if the evolution of an economic system does not follow the textbook idea of evolution, and maybe later on the textbook will reflect this world real experience. So while we are looking at a new world disorder, we are also looking for a new Adam Smith, a new Karl Marx, a new Keynes, and maybe among you and the students of this university, there is one designated soul dedicated to giving future generations an explanation of what really happens in our days. Theory doesn't fit reality, that's for sure, but that's your chance and maybe your call. While we wait for the next grand theory, there's no reason to be a pessimist. Progressive developments always happen through errors and falsehood, through trials, errors, and again we try and error, or miscalculations and untruths. That's how progressive development happens. I'm a great fan of Oscar Wilde, and he once famously said, "Everything will be good in the end. And if it's not good, it's probably not the end." Thank you for listening.
Now there's plenty of room for your questions.
First of all, thank you for your speech. I was going to ask, since we have a representative of the media here, what is the media's contribution to the recent crisis? As in, obviously we have a crisis here in Europe, but if you only look at the macroeconomic data and debts of countries, why is there only a crisis in Europe? Whereas in Japan, with a country with a deficit of, I think, 270% these days, and the United States also, at least, I don't know, quite bad. Why is there only a crisis in Europe?
I don't think so. I think we have a budget crisis also in the United States. Also, the Japanese economy is in trouble since more than 10 years. What we see now is that we are facing the fear of the financial market, especially about the Eurozone. But they are also discussing, and Deutsche Bank executives a couple of days ago told me that they fear that the financial markets could turn their face to the United States right away after Election Day and have a closer look to their budget, to the political situation, to the sustainability of their industrial workforce, and so on and so on. So I think the crisis in the Western world has different faces, and it looks more fearful and more urgent right now in Europe, because the financial market is testing our idea of Europe, testing our idea of the euro, and its stability mechanism and all this kind of stuff. But the crisis is at home in several places in the Western world.
And do you think the media somehow...
And the media is guilty anyway, that's for sure. That's for sure. The media... Okay, if you look at my book, which was published in English a couple of years ago, I think right after Lehman, no, right before Lehman, a couple of months before, I've written that the depression, which is waiting for us, is the most most predictable Great Depression, which will come, because you can see all the lies of the last 20 years in the book in the balance sheet of the big banks on Wall Street. You could see it in the balance sheet of Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. So already before Lehman crashed, we have seen the results of the what the Americans called what was the name for the housing market? Prime. Subprime, very nice name, subprime, which was right far away from prime, to give money to people who could not afford buying a house and sometimes not even afford to buy a car. So I think this sort of crisis was predictable in one sense, and many of my colleagues have done this. If you are fair to Paul Krugman and others, you also find a lot of ideas, a lot of predictions, a lot of warnings about what was coming. Even if nobody has seen that from the subprime market, the whole train goes to Greece. That was unpredictable, the connection between subprime in the Midwestern of the United States and the fall of this very small country. That was, even for me and a lot of economists, a surprise. And it is still a surprise. Greece is so small, so irrelevant. It's only in economic terms. I'm not arguing, and I'm not one of the Germans arguing against Greece that we have them, that we have to throw them out the Eurozone. But in economic terms, it's very small. It's one tiny state in Germany is bigger. It's only 4%. Of the European debt is Greece debt. Only 2.5 of the GDP of all 17 euro countries is their contribution to this. 2.5. So if you have a company, and as you mentioned, in a couple of months I become the CEO of my media company, if you have a problem, if I would have a problem in my company only in the size of 2.5 of our sales, I would be lucky. Then you would say he has no problem. how could a small problem like this, 2.5 and 4% debt ratio to compared to the other European states, rise to such an amount and huge, fear about this? This is maybe you have never thought about studying this, because this is not economics. This is psychology, and this is more in the medicine department.
Next one.
You mentioned three names which you wasted time on: Adam Smith, Marx, and Keynes. Maybe you wasted time on when you were studying, but we may want to go back and look at what they said. For Adam Smith, he was, I think, quite critical of the development that took place in its time of the move to limited liability companies. So removing the economic, or moving the economic decision away from entrepreneurs to managers which do not have, as the Americans like to say, a stake in the game, was popular when it was about tax contributions in the election campaign. And then moving to Marx, it's also quite relevant when we look at Marx's ideas about the conflict, the distribution of income within an economy between in Marx's trade, laborers and capitalists. But we can look at the share in our economy of profits going to companies and banks, especially in the globalization to the financial capital, away from wages which have in the West for a large part of the population stagnated. Real wages are flat for 50% of the population. And then we may look at Keynes, which has ideas for government to move in when the planning in the firms fails to stimulate aggregate demand, to stimulate the economy. And then your idea that we have to save in good times is not so relevant today as it was when Keynes wrote his great grand theory, because now we live in a fiat system. The money can be created by the state. There's no problem with that. The problem with debt is that it creates income distributions going to the owners of the debt, or the holders of the debt, to the banks again. So it's there's a distributional effect of the debt. It's not a problem with solvency. The problem within the Eurozone is of the structure, that we don't have sovereign governments that can create money if they need to. Well, the question is, do we really need new theory, or should we just look back at what we said?
Yeah, maybe we just have listened to a new Keynes here. If you tell us that solvency doesn't matter, that debt doesn't matter, because governments can print the money they like to have, maybe you should become a Facebook and Twitter friend with Ben Bernanke and Mr. Draghi. They believe in the same religion, that they could print money overnight, and that it's all about liquidity, and that they can sterilize this liquidity and can push it into the market and pull it out whenever they like with the instruments of interest rate policy. I don't buy it. In German history, we have seen it twice, that this sort of stimulating and overstimulating could bring a whole economy to collapse. We have seen now two hyperinflations in our history, and they all started in the same way. If you expand the amount of money you give to the people, and if it's not backed by any real products, real services, real ideas, it's only backed by the idea of a government to stay in power, that's not enough. And Mr. Bernanke right now, that was his contribution to the re-election campaign of Barack Obama. He was pouring in $40 billion of money only in the subprime market of the United States to keep the house prices stable. That shows you two things. The Federal Reserve is not really independent, and the housing problems in the United States are still not solved. We are in the year number 4 or 5 after the breakout of this crisis, and $40 billion every month to stabilize the house prices of medium-sized and middle-class families is a very, I think, clear sign that the crisis and the virus is still there, and governments are not able to kill this virus by throwing tons of money on it. It's still alive. So I think we should really remember what Keynes have told us, and Keynes has told us to save money. When the time of bridging the gap between the supply and the demand, when the time is over for this kind of stimulus, we have to save, and we forgot this second part. That's, by the way, was a reason, if you look at the life and the biography of Mr. Keynes, while he changed parties all the time in Great Britain, and at the end he ended up as a conservative because he was fed up with his followers who misinterpreted him. The same happened to Karl Marx. He never has given the advice to establish some sort of Stalinism or even a planned economy. Was not part of his program. That was not your question, so thank you.
I have a question regarding the financial market and capitalism in general, because I think we don't only have a debt crisis of certain countries in Europe, but also a crisis of capitalism in general, which you see is that the markets globalized very much, but politics didn't globalize on an equal level. So that I have, or many people have the impression that politics can't really exercise their power over the economy and control the economy in a certain sense. How do you think could leaders in Europe, but also in the world, find a solution to that, to get control again on the markets and get the system working again? Mm-hmm.
I think you are right and wrong at the same time. You are right, we don't have the framework for a global economy. We had this in each of our countries. The Americans had set a set of rules which helped them to make their economy work after World War II. We had the social market economy in Germany, Ludwig Erhard, he set the rule, and we still work with these rules, which in America mainly came from the Roosevelt era, and in Germany from the Ludwig Erhard era. And we have realized there is something bigger going on outside, and we don't have a set of rules and regulation that works properly for China, for India, and for the Western world. So the level playing field we are asking for is still a wish, but the playing field is not leveled. It's not playing. So when I lived in Washington, I argued several times with Thomas Friedman, which maybe you have read his book, The World is Flat. I think he's quite wrong. The world is not flat. The world is a rocky territory. Since all these now called emerging markets catched up and tried to catch up in the former Western world, there the flat was world. We had workers in the United States, in Michigan, in Ohio, and we had them in the Ruhrgebiet, and we had them in France. They were working under the same set of rules and regulations. Well, democratic capitalism, we called this system. We had that all people are equal. Religious rights were guaranteed. Child labor was forbidden. We had set standards for unions or for a sort of minimum wage, all these sorts of things. And we were competing under this regime, which we called democratic capitalism. And then the unthinkable happened. China entered the world market starting in the mid of 70s. India followed. And a lot of countries followed, from Asia and from Latin America. And they, and I don't want to blame them for that, but they started from a lower level, in all directions from a lower level. Not only salary, but also the standards of environmental rules and regulations, labor work, child labor, all these sort of things. And so the level playing field we are missing since that time, and the world, the flat world was crashed. And now we are looking for these rules and regulations, and it's hard to find them on the international level. But I think you're also wrong, because the mess we are in is not, we don't can blame China and India for that. This is a really a different issue. In our case, the financial crisis and the euro crisis and what has happened to the subprime market is mostly organized by a grand coalition of bankers and politicians. They have joined their forces. When the growth rates came down in the 80s, because they were skyrocketing high in the 60s and in the 70s, in the first part of the 70s, and then they came down to a normal level, you can say. But the electorate, they were used to higher wealth creation. And from there, if you look at the graphics, all politicians in all Western countries started buying wealth at the bank. Wealth creation was not part of real production anymore, or to a lower level. Growth rates were 2%, 3%, 4%, but not 8% anymore. And in the 70s and in the beginning of the 80s, they all started buying wealth at the bank account. And we see the debt was rising at that time. And this grand coalition between bankers and politicians has found a lot of ways. And subprime was only one way, to give money to people who couldn't afford it. The deregulation was the part which bring the politicians to the table, and the bankers brought the money. And if there were not enough money, a third person came into the game, the Federal Reserve, printing money. And Alan Greenspan was literally floating the money market. It was the longest period for low interest rates in the United States, nearly a decade. So these three people, these three institutions, the Fed, the banking system of Wall Street, and the White House, starting with Bill Clinton, but then it goes on to Bush, they have found that it was much easier to live with consumer and credit than with hard work, and to ask people for hard work or ask people for some sacrifice. And so that was the beginning of our today's crisis, in my view. So we can't blame China for this. We can blame the Chinese for everything. It's popular during the election campaign in the United States, especially from the Tea Party. But I think it's not true.
I read that
That's a tricky question, because it's a couple of years ago I read my book, but I have written my book, and maybe you have read it recently. I don't even remember the three scenarios. Jumped into my new book, and you are quoting from the War for Wealth, Why the Flat World is Broken, The True Story of Globalization, that was the title. Yeah, do you remember the scenarios? Okay. I think the shock scenario has started. That was written before the crisis began. That and we are in the middle of this scenario. The shock scenario means that at one day, investors worldwide jump out of their bed, and even, that came back to your question about the Japanese economy and the US economy, and even if nothing has changed, that's the surprising thing with economics, even if nothing has changed this particular morning, they will have a different look at the United States and the state of the Union. And I'm predicting that in this scenario, it could happen that financial market, big investors turn away from this former powerhouse and turning more strongly than we see it today to the new powerhouses. And they try to shift their money, and that a sort of bank run could happen to the dollar because it's obviously overstretched. So the shock scenario is that investors get nervous, and now they are nervous about the European stuff, about Greece, but the same sort of people and the same sort of mood could happen to the United States. If you look at the US and compare them with the European facts and figures, our debt ratio, our productivity, and all our jobless rates and all this, you can come only to one conclusion, that the situation in the United States is more worth than in Europe. We have here these hotspots in the South, but they are not that relevant. But where's real production in the United States? You have a couple of companies, but they are not enough for two hands. And some of them, like Facebook, are also not really contributing. They are contributing to the stock market and to the rise of their shares, but they are not really contributing to some real sort of wealth. They earn $1.2 each Facebook user. This is really a small amount of money. And look at the car industry, look at the machinery tool, all the real stuff. I think the Americans have taken the wrong path when they decided that this is a sort of old industry. If you look at Germany, and it's not because it's my country, but if you look at the industrial heart of Germany and where all the wealth came from, it came from real production, real services for real people, not from the financial sector. And also in China, by the way. So if you compare Germany and China, you see nearly the same structure. Real products for real people with real money. And all the other sort of wealth creation doesn't work. What was the second scenario? Asia all over, yes. That is the connected to the first one that we have talked about. The loser of the scenario is, in this case, the United States, that the winner could be Asia, because what we see in China are strong growth rates. And even if in our newspapers, always, you find a lot of articles, this cannot go on forever. The environmental problems are huge. The social problems are big. And party and democratic problems will arise. But so far, nothing of this has happened. Maybe it's not smart analysis of the situation, but wishful thinking of Western journalists and economists and politicians. So the Asia overall scenario means that the rise of China could lead to a new world power which overtrumps the West and brings some sort of unhappiness to our shores. And the third scenario was? The American Renaissance, yeah. Are Americans here in the room? One, yeah. Never underestimate the power where you are of your country, fellow men, to re-energize. America has shown several times that they are much quicker than all other nations to see a problem, to work hard and to fix it. So look at the energy thing, for example. The Obama administration, even if they have campaigned on green technology and all sorts of nice things, they turned completely and started, I'm not an expert in oil industry and in all these developments there. But now they really started exploring oil from the American homeland, which is deep, which is dangerous in the German worldview. We also have this sort of oil, and it's impossible in the German society even to start drill it out of the ground. But the Americans have done it. They are quick in catching up new technologies. They are quick in shifting the majority of society from democratic majority against all this kind of stuff. Drill, baby, drill was Sarah Palin campaigning on this slogan during the last election campaign, and Democrats were blaming her for this. And then a couple of months later, Obama is drill, baby, drill is his slogan now. So this is the American Renaissance scenario that America is able, and I'm not one of these doomsdayers and saying there's only one path for the future. History tells us there are always two paths to walk. The Great Depression in the 30s has two different answers. One answer was Adolf Hitler in Germany, and the other one was Roosevelt, a Democrat. Even if they were using same instruments or instruments which very look similar to each other, but there were always two different paths, and the American Renaissance scenario is also likely, and maybe tonight we get an answer to this, maybe.
Hey, I got a question about capitalism in general, the conception, because capitalism, money, like as the other guy said, is created as debt, and that means the only way to repay debt is to have growth rates that are equal at least to real interest rates, so you have to sustain really high growth rates in the long term. And I think that's not realistic because, like, just basic logic says that you cannot have growth infinitely because, yeah, the world is just limited. And another thing is that, yeah, that money is created as debt, and that what also the other guy said, I think what he meant was that, yeah, all many inequalities arise from that, that, like, the debt holders get even more and more interest rates. So it's not like the capitalistic system maybe generally misconstructed in that way, and also because you're from media, I think there is not a lot in media to read about it, about like, yeah, the general system, how it works, and you always hear like, yeah, the politician says, yeah, you want to have high growth rates in the future, but it's hardly explained why that is and what the consequences are. So, yeah, what's your opinion about that?
Capitalism is nothing which is like a stable organism. It's more like an animal or a creature. It's a living thing, so it's changing its color, its face, its habits always. So, in my new book, I try to write a history of our system. When it came up with James Watt and Mr. Rockefeller and all these guys, the first generation of people who invented the new technologies, and then two wars happened and the Great Depression, Adolf Hitler came up, and we had a really strong planned economy all over Europe at that time. We came up with a social capitalism after World War II. We had this more moderate system also in the United States. The welfare state in the United States is mostly underestimated by people who are not familiar with the subject. Even Ronald Reagan, who was campaigning as a market-driven politician, a free market-driven politician, and he also expanded the welfare state in the United States, which now nearly comes to 35% of GDP, if you put all together the benefits of the company and the government. So, capitalism is not a stable thing, and I think it's as I said before, your call to analyze it, to understand the way it changes. And while we are analyzing, we also try to influence the way the system changes. And so all the books you have to read here cannot explain what you see outside. They are only like more than history books, even if they call themselves theorists. And if you get it from your teacher as a sort of this way you have to think. This is the building of ideas, and that's capitalism looks like. But that's not true. The architecture of capitalism is changing. And we have to understand the way it is changing, and we have to fix it at some point. We have to stabilize it, and we have to help to make ourselves comfortable in this system, because it could be very aggressive. If capitalism is a system which is not touched by human beings, if it's a system on its own, that's what we have seen in the very early hour. Morning hour of this system. During the first couple of decades, capitalism was very brutal and aggressive, and not asking for the interests of workers or the interests of ill people. Everybody was on its own at that time. So capitalism is like wolves. We have to make them from wolves to house dogs. We have to educate them, and we have to pet them and to make sure that they don't get wild again. Sometimes markets get wild, and then they can hurt a whole society. And we are in a situation like this, where we have to keep an eye on where the system is walking, because we are part of it. Sort of answer to your question? I'm sorry, I don't have a better explanation for the system. It's because there is not one. And the media, I think if you look at the newspapers, the dailies, you don't find an answer to all these more intellectual questions. You have to look to different sorts of foreign affairs. I would recommend the New York Times, the weekend edition. There you have a lot of thoughtful debates about these issues, but maybe not the normal and ordinary. A newspaper is not enough for this.
Well, Mr. Steingart, first of all, thanks a lot for coming to our university. I picked from the morning briefing, although I think it became more and more a marketing instrument for your, at least for students, a bit overpriced newspaper. Well, if I just may quote the last sentence of your speech before, it said something about being optimistic to the future. Well, if I just quote one of your books, which is called Germany, A Downfall of a Star. If we have a look at the Eastern nations rising and at the Western nations struggling a lot in recent times, where do you think will this lead? And I'm asking here for your opinion and not for facts. And my second question is, well, in Germany we see hundreds of millions of euros spent for unnecessary race tracks and on other places, billions of euros are missing for green energy projects. So how far would you blame the German politics on not catching up with latest developments?
Mm-hmm. A lot of stuff. I think our newspapers offered a special student prize, so maybe you should find out. This prize, you don't have to pay the full prize. And yeah, thank you for mentioning the morning briefing. Everybody can get it as a sort of political introduction of the day every morning, written by me during the night. So when on my way back, I have to write it. So you ask about Eastern Europe? And what will happen to them, or?
What will happen to us in comparison if we see them rising on the one side, which would be directly downside for us?
Yeah, we have to, I think fear is not a good concept, not in business, but also not in life, in personal life. So, but naivete, also not. We should be very clear about what we see there, and we have to fight for our interests. If I discuss with politicians, whether in the U.S. or here, that's my view and my advice to them, to organize a debate where we can find out what are our interests, what are our values, also our moral values, and we can't trade them. And we should educate these nations because we think that a lot of our rights for women, for children, for the nature is a sort of universal right. Education doesn't mean we don't punish them. We are not the dictator of China or of anything, but we can tell them something about clean water, about education for kids, that it's maybe a better solution for them instead of working in a factory. And if we are responsible to their workforce as well, and we are responsible in the companies where the iPhone is assembled, Foxconn, a company with 1.2 million workers. A lot of Western companies from Düsseldorf, for example, it's Henkel, they brought all the material there, and Mr. What's the name of the new CEO of Apple, Mr. Cook? He was visiting just a couple of weeks ago, Foxconn. So this is part of a dialogue, and I think we should not not be too shy to have this debate with the Asian nations. That does not mean that we are their we are not father and mother of them. We are not allowed to tell them that's the only way. But we don't should blame ourselves or our politicians for raising their voice if it comes to moral values and to workers' rights and all this kind of stuff. I think we need this debate. Could that be an answer?
Do you see a downfall in our economics simultaneously to the rise in their economy?
It's not a sum-zero game, that's true. On the one hand, because we also get a lot of profits out of this development. Look at the German car industry in our days, Volkswagen. They have record earnings, 16 billion, only profit, 60 billion. That was when I started as a journalist more than 20 years ago. That was the whole sales of Volkswagen worldwide, 60 billion at that time. Now it's only the profit. That was mainly the reason is because they invested at one of the first big companies in China, and they're a huge player there, spread over the place in Vietnam, in Malaysia, and Indonesia, and all this. So we are part of this development, and it's not them against us. On the other side, Angela Merkel called the world of politicians, it's a relative world. There you have only 100% at the parliament, for example, or during election night tonight. The political power you have only 100%. It's not possible to have 150%. Even if you can raise your profits and your sales, in the political world, it's 100%. And if in the old world, we had maybe 80 to 20, the political power was located in the Western capitals, this has changed. So even if we all are combined in a winner society, the Chinese, the US, and the Europeans, if it comes to political terms, living in the relative world, we are losing political power. We are losing leverage. We can't fight it back, but we have to be clear about this development, that it's a difference between the business community. They are all lucky with China. That's the reason, because they're all winners. In the political arena, they are winners and losers. And it's hard in our today's world to bring our set of rules and regulations to other countries because we have lost political power.
How long do you think you can still profit from that? If we see, for example, the Airbus example, they asked us to build a plant in China and afterwards they opened their own plant. So how long do you think you can really profit from that, or will we just be losing scale?
Yeah, we have to follow very closely in every different factory. We have to look what happens. They are not living and working for our goods. They have something different in their mind. The politicians there are elected by the party to stimulate the wealth of their nation. even if they hurt our wealth creation in our factories. And that's what they do, obviously. We have a lot of things going on and on the World Trade Organization. I would say every German company I talked to during the last month were telling me one sort of story where the Chinese partner, and we are all in joint ventures, tried to cheat and to steal intellectual property and all these things. Yeah, we have to be aware of this. But even said this, we are partners, even if it's a difficult partnership. The same sometimes at home.
So earlier there was already a question on the important issue of growth, and our current system is built on this assumption that there will be growth forever. That's why we have the debt, that's why states said we can take on this debt because we will invest and we will have growth in the future and then we'll repay. So there's not only the financial crisis at the moment, but much more also since the 1970s, we entered a period of ecological overshoot. So would you acknowledge that there are ecological limits to growth? But also much more in Europe, I'm much more afraid of the demographic changes internally than of the bad Chinese or the Americans or whatever. And also currently the political system not being able of addressing those long-term demographic changes, which personally I think, well, the demographic changes, but also the ecological crisis that we are heading into, and just ignoring this. And also, you seem to be also ignoring this, because you talk about our wealth, but you don't ignore, where you didn't talk about those very important and critical issues, which will be very important for our wealth, by which I mean my generation, not yours. So what is your take on this? I overstated it a bit to make it controversial.
Yeah, yeah. don't worry. I was one of the founders of the Green Party in Germany, only to remind you, in the 80s. I was in the parliament for the Green Party, and I was the first generation of people working together with Joschka Fischer and Hessen and all this. But I was not part of the very radical wing of the party, but of the what we called ourselves Realpolitiker. So I'm still on this part of the spectrum, even if I'm not a party member anymore, because I think as a journalist I have to be independent, and I'm not a member in any party. But at that time I was, and we were in government, and I have different views to this topic, but it was not our topic tonight. And I think the Europeans and the whole party systems in all our countries, they have learned their lessons. Even if not everything is fixed about the water and the forest about the food and about health education and school and so on. But I think we have made enormous progress during the last 20 years. Even if the media is sometimes blamed for putting things into negative terms, I think in this case, the society and the political system and the young people, because they stay to these beliefs, they don't turn away, even if the Greens of my generation are getting older and older now and looking not like revolutionary people anymore. But I think society has made progress. So I can't agree with you on that.
Okay, we do it until 9:30.
Yeah, maybe a last or a question.
Yeah. You pick.
Yeah.
Sorry. I have a question, and I think I just want to speak more on the Chinese influence. It seems there's a lot of fear, particularly in the Western world, about the rise of China. I mean, you mentioned in your book about a possible resurgence of Europe and the U.S. as some sort of a union, and I think the way we'll look at it is a little bit out of fear, rather than it doesn't really stand to scrutiny when you look at the facts. For instance, I would be of the opinion that a rising China investing more towards other parts of the world would create more stability in other parts of the world, and that would be better for the world rather than just having a much stronger US than Europe.
where the West or the rest of the world would be dependent on those two. And I take, say, Africa, for example. I was born in Angola. And after 9 years, I went back, and I couldn't recognize it. I mean, there were demographic changes, for instance. I'd be driving on the road, and the only thing I'd recognize would be the numbers, because everything would be in Chinese. But apart from that, there is a lot of, there's a much bigger middle class. And some of this middle class sort of, it's trying to spread through other parts of the continent, and it's all Chinese efforts. There is a very massive credit lines. There is this thing we call, people now say Africa, made in China, because it sort of speaks to Chinese interest towards the region, and I think it's, in the long run, it's going to be more beneficial if we have a more balanced distribution of capital and power throughout the world, rather than being concentrated in one region. I think the idea that, say, Chinese influence is going to cost the West is a wrong one, because, I mean, face it, the West eventually is going to have to, you know, sell the product in other countries, and they have to have some sort of means, otherwise they're not going to have the products there. And I think if nobody takes those financial means there, then I think the West is just going to implode in itself. And I think people should just sort of, I think it should be looked in light of the benefits of China rather than fearing. And the other fear is just people are afraid that China gets too powerful. They just sort of, it's going to be a really, really bad power. I think that's just fear. I mean, the US spends 41% of the world's overall military. No one's afraid of it. China only has 8%. It's going to take a couple of years before it gets there. And so I think there's too much fear rather than facts regarding the rise of China. And I just want to fellowship and make that clear.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. Very interesting remarks. I think if it comes to Africa, you are completely right, because the Western Hemisphere has forgotten this continent, has made clearly no investments and has no sort of future idea what to do with Africa, how to support this continent and the people there. And then the Chinese came around the corner, starting buying in a lot of businesses there, and started not only a development you described, but also a rethinking of the Western politics in this field. I think a lot of strategists now in Washington, and as well in Paris and in London, and in hopefully in Berlin as well, are rethinking the strategy of seeing Africa only as a continent where we have to do some charity on Christmas. But instead of taking Africa as the next Asia, as the next Latin America, as the next emerging market, and not to see it, as The Economist has put it, as the lost continent. Nobody is lost. And there are so many people, there are so many stuff hidden in the ground, there are so much energy, and the Chinese were really the first focused on that and help people, even if this sort of help is completely in their own interest, but that's allowed, that's part of our system, and we should not blame them for that. So I could completely understand what you have said. On the other side, it's in the interest of the Western world that there is, even if we are not the only, and the United States should not be the only power, if there is some sort of Western dominance, I think it would help our kids and our families, our values, to stabilize, because the world is a dangerous place, and if there is some sort of power, protecting power, looking at security, not only in the field of business and energy, but also in the field of life of ordinary people, so I think still that NATO, even for the Green Party in our days, is a good idea. An army which is not there to fight wars, but to protect people and to try to prevent wars. So the Western Hemisphere, I think, is not part of history. It should be part of the future. Even if you are right, we have to learn to share our views, our political power, our business opportunities with others. That's part of the deal. And it's for a better world. Maybe this could be a perfect last sentence, huh? What do you think about that? Thank you for coming. Thank you for discussing with me.